out here for trouble, catch him Bob waiting here.
Wait. Yeah, my fault. That's correct. Only friend I've got on it.
May I suggest, Mr. Phillips, that perhaps if you behave somewhat more...
Oh, my God, nothing. I think I had it. Don't drag me out of the room.
Important figure.
meet out a flyer in Sydney once. A warning against 9-7.
That's not exactly what
I engineered a mutiny aboard an Arab dhow in the Gulf of Oman some years back. I sold the cargo at Bahrain for a pretty figure, Murray. Pretty figure.
That was certainly compounding a crime.
The cargo was illegal in the first place, Murray. You know what it was? Slaves. Little boys and girls from India.
Mr. Millet, I must ask you once and for all.
This bottle's almost finished, Mummery, so spin it up.
Will you take a job if I offer you one?
A job? Mummery, I stopped working 9 years ago. I mean, yes, working.
All right. Then I must ask you to leave this island on the next boat.
I like it here, Mummery. I'm staying here.
Well, I can't make you go, I suppose.
You suppose, right?
But I do have certain powers. The company controls the sale of liquor here, Mr. Pellet. And if I order that none be given you...
You'll do that?
I would.
Unless I take a job or leave, is that it?
Exactly.
Well, I'm not working, and I'm not leaving, Henry.
Then you won't be boozing either, Mr. Pellet.
Scotch, if you don't mind, Mummery. I think I've earned it.
Good day, Mr. Pellet. That night, the order went out to Sir Pellet no more rum. However, the skinful of scotch he'd taken on at the agent's house saw him through until noon the next day. He awoke then with a terrible thirst, and by evening he was raging. You can't cut off alcohol from a man who has been just for 9 years without results more or less violent. Karaki was impatient of a thing, bore the brunt of it all. Karaki, the little heathen from Louisville, a place where some people were smoked and others eaten. It took 2 days of awful torture to break Pellet's spirit, and then on the morning of the third, the man was shattered. Recommend the drunkard to a certain toleration. He was a brute, and he became Rocky remained true, and showered more devotion than ever upon his friend. He spent his evening down by Michael Howell's bar, patiently waiting for Helen to get drunk enough to take a long road. Night after night, the Rocky waited, while the white man stood roaring.
Bottle around in your face.
All right, I trust you. Well, hurry, man, hurry.
Helen waited in terror in the shack on the beach while Karaki broke into the boat shed and with an axe smashed the bottoms out of the three craft sheltered there. Then he opened the trade room and quickly gathered together a big bundle of supplies, including a Winchester rifle and a box of cartridges. Next, he carried everything out onto the beach and loaded it into a stout outrigger canoe that belonged to Mr. Mummery. Finally, he fetched Helen from the shack, and together they hurriedly launched the canoe in the lagoon. Karaki rigged the big mast sail and then paddled out into the breeze just beyond the harbor entrance.
We made it, Karaki. First thing.
Yes?
Where are we headed for, anyway? What island we go, Karaki?
Bougainville.
Bougainville? You crazy? That's 800 miles from here.
On the train, we go. My home.
800 miles.
We go. All fine. Always one bring you along my home.
All right, Karaki. I don't know why you're doing it, Tommy. I'll see you through.
Not the beginning of a very pleasant voyage, Mr. Christopher Pellet. The fear of being captured and hanged was great enough, but added to it were the horrors brought on once more by the lack of alcohol. The first night, he was too seasick to care, but by morning, he was raging.
Rocky! I gotta have rum. Give me rum, you blessed heathen.
Oh, no more got him rum.
Are you a bloody fool? Why didn't you back into the rum?
No more need of water. You don't need the rum. Got plenty of water.
Curse you, Karaki. I don't drink water.
More better. You drink water.
Well, I won't drink water. Karaki, turn back, please. I'll take hanging to this. Turn back, I tell you.
You'll soon catch him one big fellow in. Throw straight to Bougainville.
No. How could you find Bougainville anyway? No. Please. We're going back.
Yes. No.
More better. You rest.
Karaki easily tied the weakened white man hand and foot and continued to sail off into the open sea. Now and then he drew a dipperful of seawater over the white man and occasionally said he was coconut milk. Karaki was an excellent nurse. He even combed Pellet's red hair and whiskers twice every day. By the time they reached the Santa Cruz region, Pellet's condition had improved and Karaki released. They were now in an area peppered with tiny islands, and Karaki decided to land on the lee of one in order to replenish their water supply. He dropped sail and was paddling slowly into the beach, when suddenly, from out of nowhere, a cutter carrying two white men appeared behind him. One of the men signaled for the canoe to stop and surrender, but Karaki had other ideas.
No, Captain Karaki, you better! You better go away!
Put the gun down, Karaki. We're in enough trouble now.
However, wasted no time to back to the old sea without his precious water. And 29 days later, dancing white pelican turned to shore, and he ran into a rock swing with all the charm of the place for himself. Kuraki, in his simple and efficient way, flew east without his own affairs. He landed, but his efforts and supplies sold speed and piled them high among the east. A few minutes after, Helen heard a gentle footstep behind him and turned to find Kuraki standing there with the rifle at his hip and the axe.
Like. Yeah, me like too. Great pleasure you have here, Kuraki.
Me like him here.
Huh? Oh, well, me like him you too, Kuraki. We big fellow friends, right?
Me like him too much. One fella had belong to you.
Huh? What do you mean? I don't understand.
Red hair. Fine red whisker. Big pride here. Smoke him head. Make him Kuraki. Big man on island.
You mean you're gonna my head?
Fine head. Very fine head. Cut him off now.
That was the way, Ellie. That was all the mystery. In Kuraki's country, a white man's head well smoked was indeed a prize. But that of Mr. Christopher Kelly with his precious red whiskers was a thing to be desired above the loves of women. And the simple, patient, enduring Kuraki had served hard to win it. And did it really matter to Kelly how or why he died, since his own race would have hanged him for murder anyway?